Hey, welcome to this week's episode. My name is Joon.
And I'm Christine. Let's get ready to rock your biz.
Okay, so today's episode, by the time this episode airs, we're about 12% through the year. I don't know if you think about it that way.
I don't ever calculate it that way. No, I must
say not. From looking at, you know, November, December, and now January, and early February, we want to talk about kind of business trends that we see. This isn't stuff you're going to read like in the business magazines. Business trends that we feel like you can capitalize on in 2013.
Yes, which is always good. Yeah. So the number one thing would be people that were, it's horrible. Like, I never want to capitalize on someone else's pain, right?
But no, you're mercilessly like putting an end to their miseries.
I mean, there's people right now that are just so burnt. I mean, especially someone that's
just
been in business.
Beaten down by
the
last 7 years.
Yeah, they've been in business. Yeah, if they've been anywhere from 5 to 8 years, meaning that they had, well, if it's 8 years back, you know, they had the best times in the world, right? You know, about 6 years ago, and then crashing down. I mean, they're just done. They're so done. They're like, I want out. This is a great time to approach your competitors and ask, you know, if they're, and just throw it out there. And that's what I just recently did. You could just tell just by the way the person was just, and I
some
felt
people
bad.
Like, oh my God, yes.
Yeah, I felt bad. You know. And you just tell they're just over their business. They don't like it anymore. Yeah. I mean, and nobody should be, I mean, that's not why you went into business in the first place, you know, not to hate what you do. So that's a one huge trend right now is people are just burnt. They're over it. They'll literally walk from their business, which is to me the most devastating.
That's actually why I feel like it's merciful to give them something for the business, because some of them are just,
it carries on.
They're so beaten down. They say, forget it.
They don't even want to take the time to sell it. They'll literally walk. It'll just dissolve.
Because you have to clean it up a little bit if you're going to sell a business. You
got to carry it on as if you weren't going to sell it. And it's hard to do if you have no passion left. Yeah. So anyways, that was one that, you know, definitely happened a lot earlier than I would have thought for my business to start acquiring other ones, because we just started. But hey, it worked. And that person's super excited and thrilled and, you know, and comfortable with who she sold it to.
Whenever you're talking about grabbing market share or growing, you know, there's organic growth or there's acquisition. And I think for some reason, small business owners, because they feel like they're not a Fortune 500 company that's rating other companies, they feel like acquisitions aren't for them. But I think acquisitions in the small business world are actually easier to do because there's not tons of lawyers involved. There's some straightforward, you both have a simple business model. But really, when you're looking for candidates, it's really someone that basically, if you look at the last 5-6 years, has been hard. If they don't have at least another 6 years before that where their money was great, then they're probably a prime candidate for their tire. Because the people that had a real positive history, and just maybe longer of a positive history than a negative history, the storm wasn't as bad. Yeah, business was hard, but they remember the good times still, and they're still living off that memory. They had, you know, stuff saved up, or strategic alliances that carry them through. So they're not a great candidate, but someone that did, like, was fairly new, like 2005, 2006, and just got beaten down, that is a great acquisition to grow some market share for sure. So that's definitely a trend that we want you guys to capitalize on. Mm-hmm. Another one is, like virtual services. You know, like there's a lot of these, virtual services, like people you don't know. There's websites, Odesk, Fiverr, Guru.com. And so if you're good at what you do and you've created a system where you can do it in a very quick amount of time, where you have a lot of interns or a lot of junior members doing your core work for you, start farming it out virtually. I mean, there's no reason for you to be limited by your footprint anymore geographically.
Yeah.
You know, and especially there's all these sites that you can put your services out there. And so we were talking about, like, you were mentioning that anyone does anything for kids, or I would say anything for boomers. You know, that's like those are niches that, however, you know, there's not a lot of like for boomers, there's not tons of virtual services for them yet. But they're the fastest growing segment on social media and smartphone uses, because they haven't all bought smartphones yet.
Isn't
that's a great thing.
Baby boomers, they're turning 65 years old. There's 10,000 people a day turning 65.
Right. So if you think of any kind of virtual service that they need, because think about it, they still haven't migrated. They're kind of the last holdouts on their early adoption curve of like smartphones and tablets and stuff. But they're now buying all that stuff. And so virtual service is going to be great for them.
And that kind of ties in with convenience. So I've noticed a big trend in convenience. A lot of people come in, you know, they want things delivered to their door. People are so busy. They don't have the time even to swing by to pick something up. Can you somehow offer delivery service in what you do, what your business or product is? You know, ship it to their door, something like along those lines. I've noticed convenience is like a huge
factor right now. The most extreme example, I mean, this is not in our country, but in South Korea, there was this supermarket that was trying to grow, and other American supermarkets went over there and they failed. And they just, the big box wasn't working, but that was specifically why. The people that had money for this disposable income to buy this stuff didn't have the time. So this one supermarket just bought out walls in the subways, and they basically built virtual shelves with QR codes, and people were shopping
off of the
wall, and then it would be delivered that day when they got home from work.
But how come that Vons does delivery of groceries?
Yeah.
Why isn't that taking off at all?
I think their costs are still a bit too high for the, the thing. And I think they weren't, their demographic wasn't like a high tech savvy demographic initially. But and so that, you know, so this came out like 3 years ago, I think, in South Korea. And so this big box retailer, just they're like, how did they make it when all these other places like Home Depot and stuff failed? You know, and they're like, well, it's because they basically realized their ideal customer profile is these busy professionals who would shop in the morning on their way to work, because they would actually see on the shelf, they actually get, you know, this is what it looks like, and this is like produce and all this kind of stuff, and then that night, all the stuff would be sitting there.
Isn't
that great? You know?
See, and Amazon's kind of getting really savvy in that sense, too.
Yeah, sure are.
We started ordering more supplies, and there's some supplies we order, I know they ship from New York on Amazon. I'm like, oh man, they ship from New York, we're not going to get it for a week. Literally, it was less than 24 hours at my doorstep. I was like, whoa, now they're getting these
distribution
centers.
They're decentralizing the distribution.
Yeah, so they have one in LA now, and I was like, whoa, this is cool.
Yeah. So if you're a small business, that's one way you want to build strategic alliances. It's like, listen, we carry the same products. Our markups are different or whatever, but can you be a distribution center for me and vice versa? Mm-hmm. You know, that's just something that was really hard to do back in the day.
Yeah.
You know, but now you can be shooting texts and, you know, emails, and it's super easy to do. You know, there's no excuse anymore.
So convenience. I think sustainability is another big trend still, you know, in the marketplace. So locally grown stuff, food, veggies, farmers markets, delivering things fresh to the doors.
Yeah.
There's now like there's now Naturally to Your Door is one local company mm-hmm. where they'll deliver fresh produce, locally grown, organic to your door. That's starting to take off.
And you have to kind of, I mean, for me, like, I don't necessarily like seasonal, like this is totally not green. Some of the seasonal vegetables, I'm like, I would never eat that.
During that time
of year. Yeah, or even a lot of the same thing, you know, but a lot of them, that's why you go to restaurants and the chefs know how to make it. Something different, you know? But yeah, I mean, so you got, you know, but those are huge. There's a huge market potential. Anything that, you know, like, the world is so virtual. I mean, even though I'm plugging, we're saying one of the trends is try to make a virtual version of yourself. Because our world is so more virtual now, people are really grabbing towards only these artisan kind of things, like making, you know, baking. That's what Pinterest is, like people trying these recipes, right? Or microbreweries or anything that if you can create a physical do-it-yourself kind of thing in what it is you do, start offering workshops for people to come and learn how to do that. The reality is they're gonna end up buying more stuff from you because they realize your stuff is better than what they can make on their own.
Yeah.
But they just like having fun, you know, and then basically your branding, they're interacting with your brand the whole time they're doing some kind of workshop, you know, while you're there. So even if like, you know, if you did some kind of if you provide any kind of physical service, you want to show people how to do this. Home Depot's been doing this for years where they do these workshops, you know, home improvement workshops. They have ones the first Saturday of every month. It's a kid's workshop when they build like, you know, birdhouses and stuff. It's mostly parents smacking their thumbs and trying not to cuss in front of these other kids and stuff. But, you know, they've been doing it for years, but really every business that you do some kind of tangible thing, you know, do a do-it-yourself kind of workshop. You'd be surprised how many of your customers will love that. And they'll bring friends who had never heard of your company before. And they're like, oh, this is what you guys do? Yeah, this is really hard. We might as well just pay you.
Yeah, right?
And then, do it.
No, exactly. Yeah, that's
if you've ever brewed your own beer, you start to be like, you know what? I'm just going to go ahead and buy my, I'm going to buy my stuff from Stone because they got it down. This stuff, my stuff tastes like dirt. You know, like, it takes forever, too. It's a big, long process. But definitely do-it-yourself kind of stuff. And this is what we're starting to see, like, you and I were never big fans of people complaining about the economy, like making their business stop. But what happens psychologically, though, is everyone's reading all this, like, you know, the Wall Street's doing this, but Wall Street doesn't affect most people, you know, like all kinds of stuff. But what it did psychologically is it made everyone like hold their money really tight, even though they had it.
And then the fiscal cliff thing, even. Right. But here's the thing.
Here's the irony is that people stopped being afraid and they'd started to just spend their money. Yeah. It would have fixed the economy quicker, right? So now what you're seeing this year is, you know, Obama was very smart on this. He basically kept all this news, you know, he let some of the news leak out before around the election cycle. The economy's getting better. But the really good news is coming out now in the first couple months of his administration. That's what you do when you're an incumbent. You hide stuff, you know.
What's the really good news?
The really good news is all the economic indicators are just like way better than everyone thought. Manufacturing jobs are like through the roof and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, there's record, you know, people filing for unemployment, all that kind of stuff, right? So what that's doing psychologically is people are feeling, it's like if you've ever been in a place where you had to save up money for a long period of time because you didn't have any money, all of a sudden you got a chunk of money, you blew it all right away, right? So right now, this year, we, especially the first half of the year, capitalize on the fact that people psychologically are going to want to spend their money that they've always had, but they're going to want to spend it a little bit freer because they're hearing through the news and everything that the economy is up. So there's not as much fear in the air.
Yeah.
You know? And so people are like, man, I haven't been able to buy this stuff in a long time. Let me buy this. Let me buy that. You know? So take advantage of that and make it easy for them to buy your stuff. Make it super convenient. You know, online. You know, I just heard a story the other day where, you know, these Catholic churches were changing to have little kiosks before people went in so that people could give their offering and tithes using their cards. Because they're still using cash. But most people, I never carry cash.
Yeah.
So their giving was taking a huge hit because they still rely on passing around a plate, right? And so these, you know, the more conscientious Catholics would stop somewhere on like a liquor store on the way and get cash, which is just weird because they just forgot they don't carry cash. But they put in these little giving kiosks now. Make it easier for people to buy your stuff. People are going, I'm telling you, there's been such a long time where people have been not really conscious about not spending their money. They're ready to spend right now.
And please make sure you're accepting, first off, make sure you're accepting credit cards without a doubt. You know, Square Up, we've mentioned before, PayPal
has
a reader.
There's no excuse not to.
There's a bunch of readers. Yeah. But make sure you opt in to accept American Express, especially if you're dealing with the affluent. They use American Express. Right. Why would you say, oh no, we don't take that? And Discover.
Amex takes care of its members better than any. I mean, Visa, MasterCard, they could give a rat's ass who you are. I mean, they're just so huge. It's volume. American Express is all about member loyalty. They're big on members.
And if your business says, oh, no, we don't take American Express, well, that's one more barrier that you're...
You're definitely losing out on a more the upper income kind of segment.
It's going to annoy them probably. Yeah. So, yeah, definitely make
sure you're taking those. For Lakers season tickets, when we buy them through American Express, we get extra stuff.
Oh, cool.
Like, we get to visit the coaches and the practices that other season ticket holders can't. Because that's a relationship. American Express is big on their membership. Yeah. You know, and so they want to kind of, you know, reward those kind of stuff. Another thing, I mean, we're here at Hera Hub filming everybody. This is a co-working space specifically for women. So they just let me sneak in to do the show and stuff like that. But Christine's a member and they're thriving here in San Diego. They have two locations, another one's in this work. It's a national franchise. So if you want to figure out how they do it, and they have 500 members on this site. So, if you want to know how it's done and want to buy a franchise in your town, just let us know. We'll hook you up with the owner here, the founder. But co-working spaces are huge.
Definitely. Yeah? I see that as a huge, huge trend that kind of started a lot, you know, definitely last year. It's revving up because people want... They still want...
There's a lot of empty office spaces.
Yeah, a lot of... it's the expensive office space, you know, that they don't want, especially new businesses, right?
Right.
They don't want to work from home necessarily, but they don't want to pay for their own office, and they still want to have other people to work. They don't want to be by themselves.
That's the big thing, is you just realize, man, I'm just by myself.
And Starbucks can get old real quick.
Yeah, or someone took your couch.
Yeah.
They're like, hey, that guy took my couch. I'm always there. You can't fight. It looks... Just trust me. It looks very childish.
From my personal
point of view, when you fight with someone at Starbucks.
And especially if you get lonely. Because my friends are like, but I get so lonely. You know, I don't want to be a business owner because then I'm not with my coworkers and we're not talking at the water cooler or whatever and catching up on whatever they catch up about. But with coworking, it's kind of you still have that energy, right? You still are working alongside of other people and feeding off of their energy and brainstorming. And you go in the kitchen, you get a snack and you can say hi to people. You're not like all
isolated. And here's actually like an advanced level way of doing that. Say you already have an office and you have like three or four, you own office space, you know, it'd be great if you outright own your building, whatever. But if you have spaces that you wanna rent out or lease out to people in your field, like budding people and say, hey, it's not just I'm gonna mentor you in this space. Every Friday, we spend 2 hours talking about our business and how to grow our business. And then that's like every single one of you that has extra space, you can be offering that program right now. And because you put it online, people are going to look for it. And you're like, oh yeah, I'm an aspiring graphic designer, or you know, I don't know how to do architecture, I'm new, or I'm a new lawyer. Yeah, I'd love to do it. And I'll use saying like, hey, we're gonna get lunch catered on Fridays.
Cool.
You know, because one, that's 100% deduction, by the way, because it's a catered thing, not a business lunch. And then you get to give back, and then you got those people all building some kind of loyalty, and then hopefully, obviously, they're paying rent. You know, so that's huge. So that's another level. You don't have to build. You don't have to have like a huge like. Here at Hera Hub, it's huge, right? They got all these offices and conference room and open space. You don't have to do that to get into the co-working space business.
Mm-hmm, that's true.
You just need like, you need like a conference room kind of set up for people to have their meetings, and then like, you know, set up phone lines, and it's not that hard. You know, it's very, very easy to get into. Definitely like niche, like we're talking about niches for the affluent or just even like middle upper class. Because those are the people that actually had money this whole time, and now they're ready to spend.
Yeah.
You know? And so you were even noticing, like, what was it, like, a lot of people using debit cards instead of credit cards,
right? So I'm really crazy, and I track everything, like, you know, that happens. I love measuring things. So I pay close attention to, are people paying with credit cards, and are they paying cash or debit card, right? Because if they're using credit cards, that's not necessarily, they're going into more debt. If I know there a lot of people are buying spa services, which again is a luxury, it's not necessarily a need, and they're using their debit card or cash, then I know I can sense that the economy is getting better because, you know, the majority of people, and I would just conservatively say it's probably only 30% use a credit card,
right.
Use straight credit. So yeah,
and I think you're gonna find that more because I think that's if you have a smart clientele, that's actually what the economy taught people. Hey. Remember back in the day when we used to only buy stuff when we had money
when
for
we had
it?
Money?
Like we would save up and buy a house, we'd save up and buy a car, you know? That all turned because, you know, Ford, they were the first people that started offering financing for cars because they realized that was a business they wanted to be in. They wanted to be
the financing.
They wanted to be the financing.
I even had somebody, because we have monthly members that pay recurring, and she actually took it off. She said, let me take it off my credit card and put it on my debit card. That was one of my New Year's resolutions to pull down the debt.
Right.
She's like, I did it. So the affluent are smart too. They want the points. So
a lot
of times they'll use a credit card because they want the points because that's savvy, but you have to have a lot of self-control with that. So,
but if you have a PayPal debit card, you get points anyway.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
Pretty cool.
Okay, that's cool.
PayPal debit card.
In American Express, a lot of times you have to pay your bill in full each month. So if someone's using an Amex card, I know that, they have to pay it each month.
Oh, there's an Amex credit card too. But
yeah, that's a different.
You have to qualify for that.
Other card.
But definitely you want to, you know, definitely people are going to spend. So hit those, again, the niche markets, I would say for upper income would be anything having to do with boomers, right? Anything about convenience or instantaneous, like virtual to real transition. Anything related to kids stuff, because kids stuff often like, well, we don't have enough money for this and that. But right now they feel bad that they've been neglecting their kids for the last 5 years. You know, like, well, and it's always not hard to, it's not very hard to justify to someone that has money that their kids are worth it. That's all they want to hear. Well, it's worth it for your kids. Oh, yeah. You know, just make it easy for them to pay, lock in some longer term, like, you know, like if you're doing like some kind of classes or something like that, lock in 8 at a time. Do that kind of stuff. Be smart about it. Get more money up front. Like for the VIP packages for your thing, people can pay monthly, but no, most people just buy up front, right? They buy the whole like package.
Yeah, you can pay an annual rate. You can get, they're two separate memberships.
Right,
so we have a monthly membership and annual one that they could pay for.
Right.
Yeah.
And so always, you know, always make it so if they pay up front,
it's a better price.
It's always a better deal. Mm-hmm. Because again, you're talking about the smarter kind of end, the people that have money and they've had it for a while, but they've been very cautious.
I think another big trend, which I originally didn't go into the wellness spa industry thinking this, but I'm noticing more and more people do care about health and wellness. Yeah. And a lot of it's because of the scary Obamacare and regulated healthcare. Mm-hmm. I think that now
type 2 diabetes being an epidemic. And all kinds
so I think that it's coming to the forefront where people finally are realizing, uh-oh, if I don't take care of myself now, I'm going to pay for it down the road. I'd rather pay for it now, be healthy, you know, versus hospital bills down the road and crappy medical stuff.
Right. Just more expensive medical care.
Yeah, so I think that anything in the health, fitness, wellness sector is becoming a pretty big trend.
And if you ever want to start a business helping people do all their health insurance claims, there's probably a lot of business in that. Because I tell you, sometimes for us, like, you know, I have a flexible schedule, so I'll log in like, man, I spent 60 hours on the phone trying to get this one thing fixed.
Yeah.
I would have paid someone a lot of money to just make it go away.
Ooh, and anti-aging is another one because baby boomers. So they're really big on anything that's
boomers and kids, man. Anti-aging. That's your sweet spot right there. Just from technologically, so Christine, when you use your iPhone, how often are you calling versus like looking up stuff, internet, checking email?
Yeah, physically talking on the phone, probably like 10%.
Yeah. So that's an emerging thing. We joke about this, but there's a thing called phablet, which they hate because it was created as a derogatory, like negative term. But there's these phones, smartphones that are like the one on right now is the Galaxy Note. And it's huge. It's like this wide and this tall, you know?
That you can talk on?
It's a little too big to hold your thing. But again, most people are using Bluetooth. But phablets are the new technological thing. So if think about that, like you're optimizing your website through bootstrap technology or whatever. We talked about it in one episode. But maximizing your stuff for phablet usage, if you have an early adopter audience, every single phone manufacturer is coming out with a phablet line because they got caught sleeping. Because Samsung was the only one that kind of surveyed, hey, how often are you actually talking on the phone? Oh, it's less than 20% of the time? And you're mostly using your Bluetooth? Would you like a slightly bigger real estate? Not quite an iPad or a tablet, but you're already paying for your smartphone anyways. Would you like it to be like a little bit bigger? Yeah, I would. So they caught all these other companies sleeping, and so now all these companies are trying to jump in on that kind of stuff. You know? And the last thing I was saying, this came up through the political stuff, was if you can come up with a Latino or Asian specific, now don't be racist or stereotypical, whatever, but you know, and there's actually consultants that help you do this well, because you don't want to just translate stuff in Spanish because the literal translations don't always work. But you know, if you can target the Latino or Asian market, there is, you know, I'm specifically doing a book launch with the Asian market in the spring. They were two huge, like very wealthy populations in America that the Republican Party basically didn't acknowledge that they had that much pull. And now they're realizing, if you hear anything in political stuff, the Republican Party realizes it's about this far away from being a dinosaur, because their stance on immigration specifically pissed off those two groups, and they are going to be the majority going forward. The Latinos more in actual number of people. The Asians more in actual dollars spent. Mm-hmm. Look it up. New York Times, look up Asian giving to philanthropy. There's an article that came out just like a month ago that sheer millions of dollars that Asian American entrepreneurs or business people are putting back into this country is massive. So it's a market that got ignored for a long time because they just didn't realize they had so much money. But because they were quiet on the sidelines. And realize they're like, oh, wait a minute, if we spend this money here, we can leverage this for this. They're just pouring in all kinds of money. Some of the most successful, like Forever 21, that was founded by Asians. Most people don't know that. It's a husband and wife. You know, they're billionaires.
I love that
story. All that kind of stuff, you know?
I didn't know that story.
Yeah, yeah. But there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of these entrepreneurs that don't like Donald Trump and their face out there because they're Asian, and they just don't feel like that's the point. They didn't become business owners to get on TV. They don't want people to know they have money. Yeah. You know, but if you can cater to those two markets, if you look at Toyota, one of the reasons they're the number one car maker or car selling in the U.S. and the way they will be basically is starting 10 years ago, they were one of the very few car companies that specifically courted the Latino market because they knew they were growing and they knew that the immigrants come here kind of poor, their kids work hard, go to colleges, make a lot of money. They're finding that the second generation of kids are making anywhere from about 300 to 400 times more than their parents did.
Wow.
Think about that, because their parents are mostly in the service industry, tough labor jobs, right? But what they figured out about the Latino, these kids, is that they weren't just gonna buy one Toyota, they're most likely gonna buy 3 or 4 Toyotas off the bat. So one for themselves, one for their mom and dad, you know, uncle, auntie, and another one for one of their siblings that was in high school or something like that, because they had that much money. And the Latino and the Asian markets, those are notorious for being very brand loyal. You know, you go into an Asian market, you look at the soy sauce aisle, there's like 12 different brands of soy sauce.
Really?
And the most expensive ones, you're like, how can they get away charging $12 what this person is charging $400 for? That's brand loyalty. People will swear by that brand, even though it's the exact same ingredients.
Dang.
You know, so they're extremely brand loyal. So, but you do need to translate things. They have different values. You know, they're not, neither one of those populations are about quick fixes. You know, get rich. They know that smells like it's phony. Because there's a lot of that kind of stuff even in their own countries. And so you gotta be careful of that. You gotta, you know, they don't like the loud cowboy American kind of stuff because that bothers them. You know, so you gotta figure that even your sales style, your tone, it's gotta be a little different. So, you know, really target that market. That's a really important one to do as well, you know. just like anything, know your customers. But those are the business trends we see. We hope that you can capitalize on them. Go back and look at this episode and write down. You're a big fan of this. Like, we're actually writing down some of our episodes. Like, yeah. Write down, okay, of that idea, can I do that? No. That idea, can I capitalize? Yeah, here's the three ways I can do it. So that's how you should use this episode. We give you lots of stuff in there. Obviously, always, there's tons of bonus content on yourbizrocks.com.
Yeah. And definitely check us out on social media networks, Facebook, Twitter, and Pinterest. And join us again next week to rock your biz.
Bye.
Bye. Christine here again with today's Expert Minute. It will be on Raving Fans by Ken Blanchard. I am shocked in disbelief that I've never done this book yet. It is one of my favorites by far. This is a very easy afternoon read. It's all about customer service and just creating these raving fans about your business. I mean, you guys have heard me say it time and time again, customer service in America absolutely sucks. It is horrible. And you can just be that much tiny bit better and everyone thinks you're amazing because the standards are just so low. He tells a story. So what has definitely, you know, inspired me about this book was a story he tells about the taxi cab driver that comes out to pick somebody up, and he's like almost dressed like a chauffeur, right? He's got the cute little hat, he's in a suit, and this is a regular taxi cab driver. And you get in his cab, and then he offers you some refreshments. Hello, sir. Would you like some water, some soda? They're complimentary. You know, he opens the door for the guy. He acts like a limo driver, essentially, but he's just a cab driver. The cab inside, immaculate. It smells good. It's clean. Like I said, there's refreshments. So it was just, I mean, imagine how much this guy's getting in tips if he provides that type of a service that just blows everybody out of the water. Any other cab service. You know, and then he has these professional business cards that he gives out, you know, the guy after he drops him off at the airport. That's just one story that he talks about. But what surprises me about the book is just the different ways you can, I mean, there's so many things you can do in your own business, whatever business you have, to make the customer service experience that much better, to make it just, it's just a whole different approach to how we treat the people that come into our businesses. And again, it doesn't take much to set yourself apart from all of your competitors that are doing customer service, that's for sure. And so it's inspired me to do things differently in all the businesses I've had ever since I've read this book. And I probably read this book the first time, probably 5 or 6 years ago, is to go above and beyond. Just, I love the whole shock and awe of offering something to somebody that they weren't expecting. Like, whoa, you know, really? And it's just like, yeah. And imagine how many of their friends they'll tell that experience to. Like that cab driver. I'm sure that guy told that story to a million people. So just making sure you're creating this amazing experience that people can tell their friends about. Word gets out. You know, the reviews online show it. And that will create, you know, just take your business to a whole nother level. So again, Raving Fans, super easy read. Like I swear, it's 2 or 3 hours to read the whole book. But it's just a great common sense approach to customer service in your business. So definitely go check it out when you get the chance.
Hey, welcome to this week's viewer mail, where Christine and I get one mighty chance at answering your pressing business question. This one's interesting. And it's interesting because we both like conferences and stuff. So this one's kind of long. It's from Clay in Portland, Oregon. And he writes, so I just started my business. And I see there's lots of great conferences for me to learn stuff from, but I'm afraid of lost business while I'm gone. Should I go to them? That's a great question.
Because
I'm like a professional conference attendant.
I know, me too. I love conferences too. And I'm dying right now because I haven't been to one in a while. So I would say, and even with my very first business, I come from the mindset of you need to hunker down in your cave, your office, your home, wherever, the first like year of business. I mean, that's my personal opinion. That's because I want to grow them really fast and just blow it up, and I'm a crazy person when it comes to that. So I feel like you need to really like buckle down and just get systems in place. get that thing running well enough to where you could go to a conference and not be like tied to your phone and stressed
out really
and checking emails and, oh my gosh, is it going to fall apart if I'm not there? You know, in the beginning, you're kind of the
sales. It is going to fall apart if you're not there in the beginning.
Yeah, it would. It would. So, you know, and if you're, especially if you're the, if it's sales driven and if you know sales are happening when you're gone, you're going to miss out on that revenue. I mean, is it really, really worth it for the conference? So yeah, I mean, the cleaning business, it was like 2.5 years. And I finally went to the first conference, and it was an industry conference, meaning like, oh my gosh, all these people have businesses just like mine all over the nation. You know, we went to Texas, and then it was like, wow, I'm not alone. It was like, this is so cool. Now I'm not alone feeling. So I wish I didn't wait 2.5 years. I think that was too long. You know, I didn't
That's a little long.
I didn't know better back then. I didn't know, like, there was this, like, cleaning house. Actually, there wasn't.
You don't know what you don't know.
You don't know what you don't know. Actually, there wasn't a house cleaning industry until, like, that recent anyway. So there wasn't one before that, but... it was nice to actually make friends in the industry. So my advice is you need to be comfortable knowing that it won't fall. It's got to be in a place where you could get away without stressing out.
And I would say, Clay, it actually depends. It depends on a couple of things. One is the conferences fall into two different categories for me. One is like personal professional development. So these are conferences that are just like my own constant learning kind of thing. Yeah. And then the other group fall into specifically business development conferences. These are where I'm not going there to learn. I'm going there to learn a little bit about the industry, but I'm going there specifically because there's someone there that's going to dramatically grow my business, either as a customer or a strategic partner or like a vendor kind of stuff. So if it's the latter, if it's a second kind of conference, I would say that's probably okay to mix in one or two, but you got to be very clear on who's going to be there. And make sure you have an appointment set up with that person at the conference. Like you actually have appointments set up. I know a lot of people are like, oh, when we get there, we're just going to meet up. No. That's not good because by the time they're flying out, the people that you want to meet, if they're good at what they do enough, they're doing what I do. We schedule all my meals out before I even touch down. Nice. You know, so you got to make sure you do that kind of stuff. And I would say, you know, the second part is really, you know, do you like is this something that can really help your business in a way that, you know, you can be gone for maybe a couple of days and you're actually going to get a lot out of it? Is there something other than the conference in that city that you can get out of it as well? But like Christine said, like, you know, you've got to be dedicated towards growing your business very soon. I think you and I both talked about this, that we feel like a lot of businesses fail, and if we were honestly auditing their hours, they weren't spending time doing the right things and they just didn't put in enough hours, period.
Yeah.
And growing it, you know? And so if you can tell me that this conference is going to be something that's specifically not like on a lark or hopefully is going to get you, no, but you have real appointments with real people that's really going to grow your business, then you should definitely put that in the mix because that's going to help your business
definitely
grow. But, you know, again, there's two different kinds of conferences I think you should go to, and so figure that out. So hopefully that makes sense, Clay. Again, we love conferences.
Yes.
We love attending stuff.
I'm
always emailing, hey, Christine, you want to go to this? She's like, dude, I just started my own business. Leave me alone. I'm like, really? You don't want to go to this one? And then if we go to that one, we can go back to back. This other one.
Well, the
like,
recent one,
leave me alone.
Isn't that a 5-day one? The recent one you sent me? I'm like, does he not know that's like a 5-day?
It's a Thursday, Friday, Saturday. No, a 4-day.
Okay.
But yeah, it takes day to travel and all that kind of stuff. She's like, leave me alone and stop tempting me.
But yeah, yeah, exactly.
And this one, I mean, like, had a little bit to do with her. I'm like, it's mostly just, it'd be a fun one to go to.
Yeah.
But hopefully it makes sense, Clay, and we'll catch you next week. Bye.